What is the gone particle? When was the light that exists in our universe born? How and when was matter born? Follow us and we'll tell you the story of the universe, matter, and energy that we find in the cosmos. In previous videos on dark matter, dark energy, and cosmic background radiation, we've seen that 95% of the universe is made up of entities that scientists have called dark. These are forms of matter and energy that we can't detect or measure in the current state of knowledge. We only know that they exist thanks to the indirect effect that they produce in the universe. These entities are dark matter and dark energy. Nowadays, we can find ordinary energy either in the form of pure energy, like light or electromagnetic radiation in general, either in the form of matter, living matter like mankind, animals, plants, or inanimate objects. In physics, ordinary matter is called mass and is made up of the particles that we all know: protons, neutrons, electrons. Mass is a form of energy as well, in accordance with Einstein's famous law, E equals mc squared. Today's mass and energy are distant, but there was a time at the dawn of the universe when temperature and density were so high that matter and radiation were trapped within a primordial broth, fused together, almost indistinguishable, in magma at thermodynamic equilibrium, in which the transformation of matter into energy and the energy in matter continuously took place. This was the time of the early universe, when the most interesting and mysterious happenings occurred: the birth of matter and of fundamental particles and forces that dominate the universe, the disappearance of antimatter in favor of matter, the birth of light, and many others. In the video on cosmic background radiation, we've seen how, by going back in time, we can go back to the time when the light was born. This is the era of decoupling, in which the radiation was freed from the trap of matter and no longer held, could roam freely through the universe and come down to us today. That moment occurred about 370,000 years after the Big Bang, or according to current estimates, on the age of the universe about 13,789,630,000 years ago. We're not allowed to peek beyond the period of decoupling because electromagnetic radiation, as said, was trapped in that primordial broth and had no way to escape. We can only reproduce energy, temperature, and density conditions of the early universe in particle accelerators, making various types of particles colliding at very high energy, hoping to detect for a statistically significant number of times the presence of physical objects never seen before. We cannot observe, but we can listen to the signals that come from the cosmos, hoping, for example, to hear one day gravitational waves caused by events that happened in the early era, in order to extract precious information and tear apart the veil of mystery that hovers over the first universe. Or again, we can study the cosmic background radiation, hoping one day to recognize hidden traces of events or objects dating back to that period. Through the contributions of the greatest scientists over the years, physics of the 20th century has developed a theory, the Standard Model. This theory is the reference model because it holds and describes all the particles and interactions discovered so far in our universe. And over the years, it has been able to predict many other particles that have not been discovered yet, proving to be a reliable and consistent theory. The Standard Model divides particles into two big groups, fermions and bosons. Broadly speaking, we can say that fermions are the particles that form the matter we know: protons, neutrons, and electrons. Bosons, on the other hand, are carrying interaction particles and are responsible for the existence of forces, such as nuclear or electromagnetic force. Up to the 1960s, the Standard Model could not explain what could give mass to the fundamental known particles. Therefore, in 1964, a group of theoretical physicists tried to answer the question. François Englert, Robert Brout, and Peter Higgs introduced into the Standard Model a theory that explained the origin of mass. They temporally located the birth of mass at a precise moment in the history of the universe, about a hundredth of a billion of a second after the Big Bang. During the very early moments following the Big Bang in the universe, elementary particles were massless. They were pure streams of energy that ran at the speed of light. As the expansion of the universe was proceeding, density and temperature decreased below a certain key value, and according to the theory, what is called the Higgs field came into action. The Higgs field can be imagined as a jelly which permeates empty space. While we can visualize particles as marbles moving at the speed of light across the space, some marbles have smoother surfaces, some others have rougher surfaces. This jelly gives the vacuum the property of generating friction in the motion of the marbles, to different degrees depending on their surface. If it is smooth, the particle passes through the jelly without feeling friction and remains pure energy. If it's rougher, it gets slower and heavier. Through this mechanism, particles gain mass according to their features. Brout-Englert-Higgs theory changed the idea of mass. Mass becomes a secondary property of the particle, no longer closely linked to the matter, but rather to its interaction with the vacuum. Since the vacuum is not actually empty, but is permeated by quantum fields, the Higgs field interacts with particles and can give them mass. It's counterintuitive, but void does not indeed exist. It is not empty at all. It is a kind of prologue of matter. The vacuum virtually holds all the particles that don't have enough energy to appear, but providing the right energy, under certain conditions, it may exhibit stunning properties. A fundamental part of the theory was the presence of a scientific particle, the Higgs boson. A boson that would allow the Higgs mechanism to unfold correctly and thus give mass to all other particles. For this reason, in mainstream media, Higgs boson has often been called the God particle, from the 1993 book, The God Particle, by Leon Letterman, although the nickname is strongly disliked by many physicists, including Higgs himself, who regard it disrespectful towards believers. In 1964, Higgs boson was theorized only. For several years, it was being chased in vain by particle accelerators all over the world. As a matter of fact, to reveal it, a large amount of energy is needed, and until a few years ago, no accelerator still possessed enough energy to discover its existence and detect it incontrovertibly. In the end, LHC, Large Hadron Collider, CERN's particle accelerator that was turned on in 2008, managed to recreate in the laboratory the requested energy and temperature conditions. And in 2012, the Higgs boson was finally experimentally detected. On July 4th, a conference held in the CERN auditorium announced the discovery of a particle compatible with the Higgs boson. Higgs himself was sitting in the audience, visibly moved. The intuition he had in 1964 finally appeared in 2012. The strength of thought that was relying on clues and reason was able to travel far to the future, so much so that eyes and hands needed a new century to follow him. This is the story of an idea that broke in and changed physics. Even if LHC is the world's most powerful particle accelerator, as well as the most complex machine ever built by humanity, it had to work hard to detect Higgs boson. LHC is located at the CERN in Geneva between France and Switzerland, in a region between the Geneva Airport and the Jura Mountains, and built inside a 27-kilometer-long ring-shaped underground tunnel at an average depth of 100 meters. The machine accelerates hadron bundles, particles affected by nuclear force, at speeds close to those of light, in opposite direction, and collides them at four strategic points of the ring, in which the four main accelerator experiments were installed: ATLAS, a toroidal LHC apparatus, CMS, compact muon solenoid, LHCb, LHC Beauty, and ALICE, a large ion collider experiment. These enormous detectors meticulously analyze the particles and energies that are created in collisions. To give an idea of the proportions of these mammoth works of human ingenuity, just think that the detector ATLAS is about half the size of the Cathedral of Notre Dame de Paris, while CMS contains more iron than the Eiffel Tower and even weighs twice as much. Higgs boson production in a particle collision is likely to be a very rare event. It occurs about 1 in 10 billion collisions only. Moreover, another issue that has enormously complicated the hunting is the fact that the Higgs boson is not a stable particle. Once produced, in fact, it immediately decays, that is, it transforms into other known particles, freeing energy. Several different modes of decay for Higgs boson have been assessed and classified. There is not only one. For example, it can decay into two photons or other particles known as electrons. CERN has analyzed every single collision and checked what sort of particle it had produced, isolating only those events causing decays consistent with Higgs and discarding the others. Billions of hadrons have been injected into the LHC, producing billions of collisions. The collision analysis has requested, therefore, a stunning computational power. It was estimated that LHC has produced a mass of data of about 15 million gigabytes each year, equal to a CD stack of 20,000 meters, which corresponds to 61 times the height of the Eiffel Tower at 342 meters. This huge amount of information to analyze required a global computer infrastructure for fast data exchange, able to help scientists process them. This infrastructure is called GRID, a planetary network born at CERN, which combines and uses simultaneously the computing power and memory of tens of thousands of calculators across the world, and has been developed to store, process, share, and make accessible the data produced by the LHC accelerator. It is a network of computers spread on a global scale formed by 11 processing centers that are called main nodes, which receive data directly from the LHC and allocate them extensively to the entire network of minor nodes around the globe. Will the discovery of the God particle change our life? It has already changed it. In order to detect it, in fact, humanity had to build the LHC, the greatest engineering and technological work ever carried out, which required application and development of the most advanced technologies that enclose broad spectrum any field of scientific, technical, and engineering knowledge. From superconducting magnets to computing, cryogenics to vacuum techniques. All this progress has already been transferred into society in terms of consumer technology, solar panels, medical diagnostics, nuclear storage processing technologies, and so on. In particular, particle accelerators have plenty of applications in medical therapies and diagnostics. All the accelerators in the world are based on technologies developed at CERN or in partner laboratories. Ideas and creativity are the basis of the progress. Without new ideas, development stagnates. The basic fundamental research triggers creativity, genius, fantasy, because it has no constraints of profit or delivery of specific products. History shows that the most important progress of mankind have come directly from fundamental research, where mind could travel with fantasy and unleash the wildest and seemingly counterintuitive insights considered unthinkable and absurd. Any other examples? It is enough to consider the fundamental theories of physics, general relativity, and quantum mechanics. Without these abstract, highly counterintuitive, and sometimes absurd theories, we wouldn't be able to use, for example, our precise geolocation services, thanks to our modern GPS satellites, or we would never have developed semiconductors and transistors and electronics like we know wouldn't exist.